Well, it's great to be here again at the Developer Camp in Tokyo. Thank you for coming today and spending your valuable time. For those of you that don't know me, I'm David Ai, or David Intersimone from Embarcadero. I'm a longtime employee of the Developer Tools. And we're going to spend the next hour taking a high-level overview of RADstudio XE3 capabilities. And then later this afternoon, I'll be doing a deeper dive technical session with lots of source code and too much information. So in this beginning introduction, we'll just focus on a few key features of RADstudio XE3. And I'll go slow so that the translators back there don't go too crazy and throw things at me. This is my email address, my Twitter feed, my blog. So if you need anything, just let me know. Contact me. RADstudio XE3 continues the expansion of our focus on delivering developer tools for multiple platforms. Years ago, Delphi and C++ Builder were Windows only. But with FireMonkey and RADstudio XE2, we added support for Macintosh OS X operating system. We're continuing that work today to expand our reach across the versions of Windows, including Windows 8 look and feel, and the new Mountain Lion version of Mac OS X. We also are releasing the second generation of the FireMonkey business application platform with new capabilities. To save time, we call it FM2 or FM Superscript 2. We also have support for HTML5 in a new product called HTML5 Builder. And towards the end, I'll talk about our mobile strategies across multiple platforms. So Windows 8 is now in release from Microsoft, but not quite available yet, not until sometime later in October. But of course, many of you have existing applications, VCL applications, FireMonkey applications. And you might be wondering, how are you going to get to Windows 8? And there's two parts of Windows 8. There's the operating system, and then there's the look and feel. So Microsoft calls the user interface style the Windows 8 style. Now the Windows 8 style is also available on Xbox Live and on Windows Phone 7.5. So in RADstudio XE3 and Delphi and C++ Builder, we are allowing you to use the style capability of your VCL applications and FireMonkey applications to create a Windows 8 style look and feel. If you've seen it, and I'll show you some examples, bigger blocks, a specific nice looking font, bigger buttons and checkboxes. So if you're on a touch screen, you can touch the control without hitting the control next to it. You don't have to do anything special in your VCL and FireMonkey applications other than choose a style. And then you can have the Windows 8 look and feel Not only if you're running on Windows 8 operating system, you can have that same look on Windows XP, Windows Vista, and Windows 7. We're the only development company to give you that look and feel across all the versions of Windows that we support. We call this our Metropolis user interface. Playing on the name Metro that Microsoft used to use, which again now is called the Windows 8 style. You're not required to use it. You can keep your VCL Windows look and your FireMonkey vector drawn look for Windows and Macintosh. But you can choose to start moving or have versions of your applications that have this new style. And again, it's the same source code you already have. Just set the style that you want or change the style when you need to. In XE3 today, we're providing our same native code compilers. Microsoft Windows 8 also has this thing called Windows Runtime, or WinRT. It's an alternative interface for developers from the traditional Windows SDK. Our compilers today generate native code for the Windows SDK, but we give you that Windows 8 look and feel. We're working on support for WinRT for the future. So when we have those compilers and runtime libraries done, we'll get them to you, and then you'll just recompile with the WinRT runtime library versus the Windows SDK, and you will have a Delphi or C++ WinRT application. Today, we're supporting the Intel processors and the Intel Atom processor. In the future, we'll also have versions of our compilers for the ARM processor, both for mobile and for some of these tablets and other desktops that are going to choose to use a non-Intel processor. Today, we're still Intel compilers for 32-bit and 64-bit Delphi and 32-bit on C++. So again, the Metropolis is a style that we deliver, and we have several different styles that you can choose from. We also have some project templates so you can get started. There are three standard styles for Windows 8 style. There's the blank or empty style. There's the grid and the split layout style. So we have project wizards for Delphi and for C++ that allow you to start a Metropolis UI, and then you add your database controls, your other buttons and things. And when you drop your button down, it will look like a Windows 8 style button, a Windows 8 checkbox. But under the covers, it's still checkbox dot enabled equals true, right? Or checkbox arrow enabled equals true for C++. If you're using FireMonkey, we also give you access to all of the device sensors that are available on the Windows Intel platforms. So camera. In my case, I have a Samsung Slate 7. It has a forward-facing camera and a backward-facing camera. There's a call in FireMonkey to get the devices that are available on the platform you're running on. That's one of the enhancements in FireMonkey 2. So you'll know if you have a microphone. You'll know if you have a camera. You'll know by querying the interface all the devices, accelerometer, GPS, whatever is available on the platform. And if there isn't a GPS, and you can install a driver that will give you the location either from TCP/IP, some tower that's nearby, or some known IP address, you still can get the location. We have a location component for FireMonkey. All right? And of course, again, as I mentioned, camera and other things. So let me figure out how to switch. Well, no, let's do it this way. Let's sit on the machine I'm on right now first and bring up the IDE. And we'll say File New. And notice in the File New menu, you've got a VCL Metropolis UI for Delphi and a VCL Metropolis UI CBuilder. And the same thing for FireMonkey. So let's build a FireMonkey Metropolis grid UI application. So now it has the bigger blocked tiles that are grouped together, and it defaults to the black style. But you can always change the style. It's a FireMonkey application, so there's a style book. Just right mouse click and say, let's change the style to be Metropolis Blue. And let's apply to all of it. And now we have a Metropolis Blue grid style application. And the same thing on a slate or touchscreen device. You can do the manipulations that you would expect in FireMonkey and in VCL because we now support gestures and touch in both VCL and FireMonkey. If you build a VCL application, let's put a button on it, we can then convert that VCL application. You just right mouse click on the form anywhere, whether it's a VCL or FireMonkey app that you have today, and say convert it to a Metropolis application. Choose the style you want, Metropolis Green. And when you compile and run it, you now have a Metropolis Green application with a little bit bigger button and bigger font. And notice that it changed the font to SIGO font. That's the standard font now of Windows 8 and Microsoft's logo and all. You can change that if you want, but that's the default behavior for choosing to make your application look like a Windows 8 application. So you can start from scratch, or you can migrate your applications. And the same thing for FireMonkey. New, FireMonkey. Put a button. Right mouse click, convert it. Now it comes up by default as black, but we can go into the style again and change the style to a different Metropolis. And hit apply and close, hit run. Notice there's no caption, there's no minimize and maximize, there's no close button. That's all done in the application for you. And if we were on a Windows 8 machine, we'd see the additional icons of close and show up. So now let me figure out how I'm going to switch desktops. So this is a Windows 8 Samsung slate, right? And we've got the IDE installed. and we can open up a GPS application. So this is a FireMonkey application with a location sensor component, non-visual component right here, called T location sensor. And when we choose this checkbox, it'll activate the sensor and it will give us the latitude and longitude through the GPS in the device, where in my case, I've installed a free third-party driver for Samsung Slate called GeoSense, which will go out and find the closest known access point to get the longitude and latitude pretty close to spot on. So let's run this one, activate the sensor. It says here's the latitude and longitude, and then the button's just going to launch the default browser, call Google Maps, and it's going to tell us that we're in the UDX building, right, in Akihabara. So again, in FireMonkey, for multi-platform, you can use these sensor interfaces. There's a new structure in FireMonkey for getting a list of the devices and querying by types of devices what's available on the computer you're running on. You say, show me all the video devices that know how to grab pictures or video. Show me all the location devices. Show me the accelerometer devices, whatever they might be. Or just give me the whole list. And I could make that a Metropolis style just by doing a migration of the look. And then the checkbox would be a bigger checkbox with a check instead of the traditional Windows look. Here's another application that uses the accelerometer. So we have a motion sensor component called T-motion sensor that if there's motion sense in the device, it will display the values. Now the Samsung Slate 7 currently has a driver for the X, Y, and Z axis, just three axis of motion. They're working on a driver because the hardware has six axes, not only X, Y, Z, but yaw, roll, pitch. Once that becomes available, just install it in the hardware, and your FireMonkey application is already ready to get that information, and it will give it to you. So let's run this one. So you'll notice that in the left-hand column, the ones in the middle column that say NAN, not a number right now, that's because there's no interface. And you can get, for the sensor you're talking to, the camera or whatever it is, you can query that information and get the string, for example, from the company that makes the device. So this just gave me a string back, you know, ST Microelectronics three-axis accelerator. So if you wanted to do something special in your code, you could have logic in your application to see what devices and manufacturers and maybe do something special. But otherwise, the location or the motion sensor will give you back the values, and you can use that in your application, whatever it is. Maybe it's a game or some other kind of user interface. Okay. One last thing on the Windows 8 development. We have a technology that you can use in your VCL and FireMonkey applications for Windows 8. It's a non-visual component called a live tile component. And what the live tile non-visual component is it It's used to communicate from your application. If it's running on Windows 8, it'll communicate either a wide or narrow tile display and information of your application that gets updated. Again, it's a native code Windows application written in VCL and FireMonkey. But we have a service that you can install on Windows 8 that runs in the background as a service, Windows service. And this live tile will communicate with it, and that service will then communicate the information from your application to the Windows desktop. So I have that application running. The wide tile has the beach scene and also the text tile version of it. And if I go in and... So now notice that when I held down the stylus or I used the mouse, up comes the control panel interface for Windows 8, and I can say, let's use the small tile. Right? So now we've got different picture and different text. And again, I define this as part of the live tile system and an event that just sets the images folder for the live tile so it can communicate back to Windows 8, telling Windows 8 tile desktop to display information. So you can write this code, and it all comes to you by using this one non-visual component called tLiveTile. And again, you don't have to put that component in your application, because we've tested VCL and FireMonkey applications, and they run just fine on Windows 8. Whether you use the Windows 8 style or not. All right? So for Mac OS X, we still support Snow Leopard, we still support Lion, and we now support Mountain Lion version of the operating system. Your native code applications built in FireMonkey, in Delphi, and C++ will work on Mountain Lion. We also have added code to FireMonkey so that when it runs, it can check to see if you're running on the new Retina display of the Macintosh, and it will use the Retina style that we provide for you automatically. So if you run a FireMonkey Macintosh app on a MacBook Pro that's not Retina, it will do the right thing. It'll display in a nice-looking screen with fonts. If it sees it's running on a Retina display, then it will choose the right style automatically. If you want to program an application only for Retina, that's your choice. You can do that as well. Again, you have full access to audio, video, camera, whatever sensors are available in the Macintosh computer that you have. We also support the choice of vector drawn controls and bitmap controls, bitmap style controls. So if you want pixel perfect for a specific platform, you can choose bitmap styles. We provide several, and I'll show you one in a little bit. If you want vector drawn so it's the same look on all platforms, you can have that choice in addition. That is now an option for FireMonkey 2. Your choice, vector, bitmap. In Windows and Macintosh, you can also choose to style the non-client area of your FireMonkey application. So the title, the menu bar, the buttons for minimize and maximize, both for Windows and Macintosh. In FireMonkey 1, we only let you style the client area. Now you can style the whole contents of your application. And again, all of this is available in Delphi and C++ Builder. So FireMonkey 2, or FM2, is a major upgrade with lots of new capabilities, lots of quality enhancements and performance enhancements. Of course, the support for new operating systems, as I mentioned. We've also added in some of the features that were in VCL that weren't in FireMonkey 1 are now in FireMonkey 2. So anchors, actions, touch and gesture, including custom and interactive gestures. Multimedia with audio and video is all supported in FireMonkey 2. Again, we've gone through and improved the use of the GPU and improved the performance of the animations and other capabilities of FireMonkey, and will continue to improve and enhance. So one of the things that's happening under the covers is the hardware is changing. The GPUs are getting new capability. And so with FireMonkey, we can take advantage of that new hardware and continue to give you a great performance of the FireMonkey part while we continue to work on the compilers and the code optimizations. So let's take a look at a couple of FireMonkey examples. Here's a media player. So it's got a media player component, like the media player in VCL. You have a file name property where you can put the MP3 or WAV or MP4 or MOV video file. It also has interfaces for supporting additional formats of audio and video. There's a manager interface for adding additional support for other kinds of multimedia formats. FireMonkey 2 has several already built in and known support. So MP4 on Windows, MP4 on Mac, AVI on Windows, and such. MP3 on both. So the two parts are the media player component and the media player control. The media player control can be whatever size you want, and then the video will be scaled into that size. So in this case, the media player control is aligned to the client area that remains after the track bar at the bottom and the menu at the top, or the rectangle at the top that has these items. It has anchors, left, top, and right bottom, so it's anchored inside of the container. And so let's run this on Windows. We'll load a file. So here's Turtles in Barbados. It's an M4V file format. So there it is on Windows. It has audio, but I have the sound turned off. You'll just hear the sound of water splashing around in the background. And you can change the volume. That's just an interface to the media player. You can pause and play it. And you can change the current position in the video. In this case, I'm using a track bar to do that. So there's a property called duration, and you can set the duration if you want to skip to some point in the video. And this is a video I shot underwater in Barbados last April.